Welcome everyone to another in the Pakistan at 100 podcast series. I'm delighted to have my friend and colleague Dr. Hadia Majid here with us today. Hadia is one of Pakistan's leading lights in the study of women in the workforce, and that is what I'd like to ask you to talk about today. We know that women's labor force participation in Pakistan is amongst the lowest in the world. This was also an important finding or a point of emphasis of the Pakistan at 100 report that the World Bank launched earlier this year. But I'd like to ask the expert to sort of flesh this out a little bit and talk more about issues here. So Hadia, welcome and over to you.
Thank you, Ali. I'm delighted to be here. So I jump right into it. So female labor force participation in Pakistan is, according to the 2017-18 reports on this, at 20.14% to be precise. Mm-hmm. And the issue with this is, of course, it's low in and of itself, but what we see is it's the lowest in the region, barring Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. Where we get a lot of these numbers as far as labor force participation is concerned is from a survey that the Pakistan Bureau of Statistics carries out every year, in mm-hmm. fact. Barring some years. This is called the Pakistan Labor Force Survey. It's a nationally representative survey, which means that it covers the entire country. It takes a sample of people from the entire country, and it asks questions on the kind of work that they're doing, the kind of hours they're working, what type of work they're doing, where they're doing it, what are the working conditions that they have. So it's a very extensive survey. And what we know from this is that women not only participate at 20%, they work considerably fewer hours than men, for example. So women are working approximately 35 hours a week, which comes out under Pakistan's official definition to be about part-time. So women are only working part-time.
Hmm. And you know, those of us who've had the privilege of spending any amount of time abroad, especially in other developing countries, we'll understand that it's not just in the developed world, but also in the developing world, where we find women participating much more vibrantly in economic life than it seems to be the case in Pakistan. In particular, I think, you know, in other Muslim countries also, women's participation rates seem to be higher. It seems the way this has been characterized to me by colleagues in the past is that we're trying to do economic activity with one hand tied behind our backs. Can you describe a little bit more about the extent to which our labor force participation is low compared to others?
So if you consider Bangladesh, for example, which I think is a very interesting comparison, because Pakistan and Bangladesh used to be one country at a time, at a point in time, then Bangladesh and Pakistan share religion. So we're looking at maybe one third of what Bangladesh's participation rate is in Pakistan. There is one caveat to this entire discussion that I must make right at the outset. The statistics that we see around us being hammered on and on about are about formal labor force participation, okay, which means that this is participation that is perhaps better remunerated, it is or easier to categorize. There is another labor market, so to speak, which is considered the informal labor market. And the informal labor market is notoriously difficult to categorize or to get any handle on. And particularly in the Pakistani context, we really haven't seen any national surveys which really tell us what is the state of the informal labor force. The problem is that most women, so if you look at some numbers, we see that 78% of non-agricultural employment of women is in that informal workplace. So some strides have been made. The Pakistan Labor Force Survey now has something called the Augmented Labor Force participation rate, and in that we are looking at 34%. That is still very low, and that is because of the fact that we still don't really understand how to map the informal labor market very well.
And this is true for, I'm trying to interrupt, but this is true for men and women.
Yes.
Is there a qualitative difference between the informal market and the formal market? Do we have a handle on that?
So the qualitative difference is in terms of benefits that you have in the formal versus the informal labor market. So there are two reasons why economists are concerned about the size and the scope of the informal activity. One is that the informal labor market doesn't get counted towards GDP, and nobody likes that, right? Because it understates what your actual GDP is. Actually, there are three reasons. The second is that the informal labor market is not taxed. We don't like that either. Not only economists don't like it, but the government, of course, doesn't like it either. Because if the majority of your economy is informal, then there is a huge tax revenue that you are potentially losing mm-hmm. out on. Mm-hmm. The third thing which economists, and particularly developing economists, don't like is the informal market is completely unregulated. So any worker who works in the informal labor market, they don't have any types of worker benefits. They a lot of times are working in occupations and under conditions that are frankly hazardous. So they could be dangerous to the lives of these individuals.
Sure.
And what we're seeing is that women are overwhelmingly represented in the informal labor market. And this is true not just for Pakistan, but around the world.
Right. So, but sort of while we're on this topic of the qualitative differences between men and women, in the labor force, can you flesh out a little bit more on this in terms of the different sectors? What does the average man versus the average woman in the labor force look like in terms of what sector they're in terms of the type of job, number of hours worked? Tell us more about that.
Sure. So right off the bat, the formal labor force participation of women is 20%, like I said earlier, and that of men is 60%. Mm-hmm. That in itself should tell you that there is a large percentage of both men and women working in the informal labor market, because men's participation is just being recorded at 60%. We would think it would be much higher. Men are working about 51 hours per week. As per our surveys, women are working 35 hours a week. Of the women who are working, the vast majority, about 78%, are in the agriculture sector.
Mm-hmm.
What we're seeing over time is that there has been a movement of men away from agriculture and towards manufacturing and tertiary sectors, which bodes well for men in particular and for the families where they've seen this movement, because the manufacturing and tertiary sectors pay more. Not only do they pay more in terms of wage rates, but there are more benefits associated with these sectors as opposed to the agriculture sector.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at the manufacturing sector, for example, 78% of women in the manufacturing sector are actually working from home. They're working from
home. How does that work? How do you manufacture at home?
So some of this goes back to the idea that we have surrounding the informal sector. So there are supply chains which make use of workers who are sitting at home, and the worker then gets fed into the supply chain whilst they're working out of their home. So they could be doing sewing for the firm from
right.
their home.
Right.
They could be doing... So this is particularly true for things like handicrafts or garment industry, things of that sort. The other point that I want to make is that women, more so than men, tend to be on casual contracts. Now, this is problematic because casual contracts, as opposed to what we call regular contracts, do not offer social security, they do not offer insurance, health insurance, they don't offer any type of worker benefits.
Mm-hmm.
And these are the type of jobs that women do, more so than men.
Any other qualitative differences in how men and women differ in their work?
Sure, yes. So according to my work, the wage difference between men and women in the Pakistan labor market is about 60%. So women earn only 60% of what men earn.
Mm-hmm.
This holds true even when you're looking at women and men of the same education level working in the same occupation.
Mm-hmm.
So there's something going beyond just what you might consider human capital differences. Men do have higher experience as compared to women in the labor market. So they are in the labor market with more experience as opposed to women. The men.
So there's some evidence from other countries that part of the reason that women's wages are depressed is that when they bear children, they have to spend time away from the market, they accrue less experience.
Sure.
Do we have a sense of how much of the difference in salaries is due to quality differences or experience differences? And quality would be both because of amount of time being invested. It could also be because of differences in human capital accumulation, which is education, and how much of it seems to be pure discrimination after all of these other factors have been accounted for?
So I can't give you figures on this, but what I can tell you is that one of the main reasons in our national surveys, which women cite as the reason why they're not working, is that they have a high household and childcare burden. Mm-hmm. So that is given as their primary reason for not working. Sure. What we also know from our time use surveys is that women are spending multiple amounts of time as compared to men on childcare. Mm. Now that takes a toll. By the way, this holds true whether the woman works or not. So whether the woman is working or not, she's spending much more time at home taking care of the children as opposed to the men. Mm-hmm. So that is something what we call the double or even the triple burden. So what that means is the woman is spending time in the office and she's also spending time taking care of children. So she has a double burden as far as time is concerned. She has very little leisure time left at the end of the day. She has very little time left to herself or to just relax for a little while, right? Reproductive burden, which is what we call it, the time that the woman is spending taking care of household chores, taking care of children, that is a major deterrent for women to enter the labor market. They realize that given that they have to bear this responsibility and it would just increase their burden or it would just reduce their leisure time, they may just be then rationalizing that why should I go into the labor market to begin with, right? Mm. This becomes especially relevant when you consider that the labor market in Pakistan for women is hostile. You talked about human capital differences. Despite the human capital differences, so my own work shows that even if you have the same education level, you're still earning less than men, then when I go to that workplace, the attitude that I face is hostile, and when I come home, I have to take care of my children and do my household chores, and why should I be in the labor market if that's an option for me. I will just opt out.
So I was just going to ask, it's interesting that you were comparing how much men work and women having to take a disproportionate burden of childcare and other household tasks. Within the household, you teach a course on the economics of the household also, the expert here. Is this primarily because men are powerful and lazy? Or is it also because they're doing work that maybe takes up more of their time or keeps them away from the house or anything of the sort?
So I think that's an interesting point. So I like to pivot it back to labor force participation a little bit, and then I answer it more in terms of the bargaining position or the bargaining that takes place, the tussle that takes place within the household. Right. So one thing is, like I said a few minutes ago, that there is about 80% of women who are in the manufacturing sector are working out of home. Mm-hmm. So one of the reasons why they're working out of home may well be that it allows them the flexibility to then take care of the childcare burden and the domestic tasks, sure. Right? So what we're seeing then is that there is, like you're saying, a difference in the very nature of work that men and women are doing. Women, for a multitude of reasons, one of them, of course, being the kind of social norms that we have, the conservative culture that we have, or the mobility restrictions that we have on women, in addition to the reproductive burden that women face, may be keeping women in certain types of job and may be forcing them at home. And at the same time, the same sort of social norms and structures apply to men as well. So there is a social construct that the men in Pakistan operate out of, and mm-hmm. it is that social construct makes it, well, I wouldn't say compulsory, but encourages them to go out of the home and work, right? So it can pivot both ways, right? So that's one thing. The second is that it's not necessarily about men being lazy or not wanting to be, or not wanting to take care of their children. We are now in a time where it is still acceptable for men to pitch in. You are seeing, at least anecdotally, more talk about men also helping out in household chores.
But so I wonder whether that cuts across society at large or whether it's a particular group of people.
Sure.
I can't say. So before we move on, you'd mentioned that there's some hope. So we've had upward trajectory in labor force participation. Is that right?
Yes.
And how much is it? Is that cause for celebration?
So we've seen an 85% increase in women's labor force participation in from 1990 to 2017, right? 85% sounds like a big number when we consider that the 85% means that women today are at 20% labor force participation as opposed to 12% or thereabouts in 1990. So there's also work by IMF that suggests that if we were to reduce the gap between men and women's labor force participation, we are potentially looking at a 30% jump in GDP. So I mean, we're looking at substantial losses as far as GDP is concerned because women don't participate. Yes, there is cause for celebration that we are seeing more women in the labor force, but Vision 2025 wanted or set out to increase women's labor force participation to 45%. Mm-hmm. So we are, even though we've seen major gains, we are not where we want to be. And the way things are in 2017, it doesn't look like we're going to hit our target of 45%. The other thing that we are not thinking about is the nature of work that women do. You categorically asked me to list what type of work men do versus what type of work women do. And I talked about the agriculture sector. One of the things that I didn't mention is that within the agriculture sector, women, 80% of women are working as unpaid family help. Mm-hmm. So even when women are working, they're either earning very low wages or they're not earning any wages at all. We see very little ownership of assets by women when they, if they go into business. We see very few women going into business. We see women coming into and out of the labor force on a frequent basis. This is what we call take-up of survival jobs. So anytime there's an issue as far as the household is concerned, let's say you have some sort of shock, you go below the poverty line, the woman will enter the labor market. But as soon as the household becomes better off again, the woman exits the labor market. So what we're really seeing is that women are not, even today with improved labor force participation, women are perhaps still not bona fide workers in our labor market. They're still just considered what we call secondary workers.
So the urgency here is that every year that we have lower female labor force participation, we're leaving money untapped. We're not growing at the rate that we can be, and there's an exponential impact of that, of lower growth rates. But you know, the whole Pakistan 100 enterprise is about being positive and thinking about where we can be in the year 2047. I was just thinking, as you were speaking, we've had an 85% growth in labor force participation in the last roughly 30 years, and we're roughly 30 years away from 2047. So let's think about, and hopefully the next 30 years can be slightly better than the last 30 years. So let's say that we've got 100% or more, let's say 150% increase in the labor force participation in the next 30 years. What do we need to do to get there? How do we tackle this problem? How can we encourage women to participate more?
So some initiatives have already been taken. So the women development departments across the country have funds which allow for the setup of daycare facilities, right? Mm. That is one of the major...
But hang on, sorry to interrupt, but I don't see these daycare facilities.
Yes. So what happens is that you're supposed to apply to the development department and say, okay, look, we want to set up a daycare facility. They will give you funds for it. They also have a strict guideline that you have to follow. One, people don't really know that there are these funds available for daycare facilities. Two, the guidelines, I've taken a look at the guidelines, they're comprehensive, they're exactly what guidelines need to be when it comes to these daycare facilities. Mm-hmm. But they are then beholden to these guidelines. If you apply for those funds, then you have to follow those. Second, there's not a norm of daycare facilities in Pakistan, right? You rely on family networks. The problem with relying on family networks is that they may not always be there when you need them most, or women may still be expected to continue to fulfill all of their household tasks, mm-hmm. Take care of their children, even while they're working. So it becomes difficult for women to manage this as number of children increases, and then eventually they just drop out of the labor market if they go into the labor market to begin with. So one of the first thing that always comes to people's mind is, how do we reduce the reproductive burden, perhaps by introducing all of these facilities? Mm-hmm. One of the other things that we need to consider is transportation. So we know that mobility restrictions are there in place for women. One of the major plus points that women respondents in certain firms have talked about as far as their firms are concerned is whether or not they provide transportation facilities. That's a really important consideration for women when they're entering the labor market.
So this is, you're referring to your own study on this?
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, so this is ongoing work. This is work that we're doing, which is basically where something called Job Talash, right? And we are interviewing firms and we're matching firms with employees. And one of the things that we talk to these potential employees about is transportation. There's some other work that has been done by an organization here in Punjab, which actually looks at industries in the Punjab area, and they've done an extensive survey with these industries. And one of the things, again, that they talk about to the women employees there is transportation.
So mobility, I'm sorry to interrupt, mobility is something that matters both for women workers, but also girls who are going to school or for vocational training. We know from literature, not just in Pakistan, but there's a famous study in India where they give these bikes to women. Within Pakistan, we know that whether there's a school van for women, for girls going to school, matters to how often they go to school. So one takeaway is improving women's transport, both for the workforce and for school.
And in that, we cannot discount the importance of public transport.
Absolutely.
Yes.
So public transport is a key factor. That's one takeaway. What others do we need?
And when we're thinking about public transport, we also have to consider the route that is taken to get to the public transport. So we are thinking a lot about how to connect our city, but are we thinking adequately about pedestrian-friendly pathways? Mm. Even when we're thinking about pedestrian-friendly cities, are we thinking adequately about lighting, about security? That is how do we reduce vulnerability of women when they navigate the city?
Absolutely.
Then we need to start getting creative. When we think about vocational training, most people's mind turn towards giving women sewing skills, giving women handicraft skills. When you talk to operatives in the field, however, they tell us that this handicraft training and this sort of vocational training is good, yes, but this is not going to increase women's employment or their earning capacity to the extent that we would like to see it increased.
Mm-hmm.
You talked briefly about bargaining within the household, right? There is a whole set of literature that talks about how important it is to provide women with employment or income earning streams and how that impacts the woman's position within the household and allows her to bargain for or fight for not only decisions that relate to herself, but also decisions that relate to her children. In that context, a small bump in income is not going to make that much of a difference. We want to see a big bump in difference. In that context, a bump in income coming from informal work is not going to make that much of a difference. The bump in income coming from formal sector manufacturing employment with a regular contract makes much more difference. There's a whole lot of literature on that. So when we're thinking about getting women into the workforce, we want to think about the kind of work that they're doing. We want them to be in regular contracts. We want them to be in...
I'm just going to interrupt. I know what we want. How do we get there is the question now.
Sure. So how do we get there? Maybe we need to think about rescaling our vocational training institutes,
mm-hmm.
but change the nature of the vocational institutes themselves, right?
Yes.
Maybe not teach sewing over there. Maybe teach welding over there. So there was a really interesting conversation that I had with some people who work in the field, and they talked about how there's certain supply chains that you can look at, maybe the marbling industry or the plumbing industry or the welding industry, and that is where you need to be focusing your vocational training institutes. You also what we want to put some money into is supply chain connections between women workers and their potential employees.
Mm-hmm.
So providing them training is not enough. You want to network, provide, build their network for them.
Okay.
Women more so than men are less exposed to these sort of networks. So once they've gotten that training, can they really get a job? In most cases, they can't unless you also help them build their network. Then finally, there's some very interesting technological-based solutions that have come up in the last few years. Mm-hmm. There is a whole bunch of our educated women sitting at home, right, not working.
Sure.
Female labor force participation for those with tertiary education is just 32%.
Mm-hmm.
How do we think through, given the kind of reproductive burden they have, given the kind of constraints that we have, that they have, can we transform a labor market using technology? You have use of technology in education, you have use of technology in health. Doctors are being connected to remote areas and providing services while sitting at home. Educationists are sitting in an office providing or at home providing facilities to rural areas. This has impact from both, not only the fact that women who were out of the labor market can now be a part of the labor market, they can help mentor and bring up the next generation of women, right? Increase
sure.
the human capital.
So I'm going to just, I have a little bit of work in this space in technology for development. It can have a massive impact, but it can also be impacted in turn by existing societal norms and
sure.
And whatnot. So just we need to wrap up. I just want to recap a few of the things that you've mentioned. You've talked about women's mobility and safety of navigation to the workplace. You've talked about improving vocational training, about networking women to better jobs. You talked earlier about education, and we have an education gap also, right? But a lot of, excuse me, a lot of what you've talked about today has to do with culture and norms.
Sure.
So I'll give you the final word on this. Would you say that that is the missing link? And do you think that we can move the needle on culture in the space of, let's say, the next 10, 15, 20 years?
So that's a tough point, right? Because cultural change generally, so what you want to see is, you want to see the cultural change organically, mm-hmm. right? And you want to see the cultural change, we think of the cultural change, or we want the culture to change in a particular direction, right? There's nothing to say that it'll change in that direction, one. Secondly, how do you move the needle on cultural change? So there is some work on, experimental work on this, right? Where you introduce role models through media, or you introduce physical, like role models go to these localities. And through the presence of those role models, you perhaps see some change in norms. That is, you're pushing the cultural change in a particular direction. Organically, cultural changes take place as economies mature, right? So as Pakistan urbanizes, Pakistan is already fairly embedded in global trade. Educational achievement is something, or educational levels are improving in the country. That in itself should organically lead to cultural changes, right? And you can't deny the importance of economic pressures. We have a society whose states are changing, maybe becoming more consumer driven. Fertility rates remain high. We want good, families want good education for their children because that is what makes them locally and globally competitive. We just are not in a position where we can afford to have a women sit at home. And that in itself is going to push women out.
All right. Well, Hadia, thank you very much for all of this. This is such an incredibly important area for Pakistan to work on, because in the next 30 years, by the time that Pakistan is 100 years old, how much we develop depends on our ability to answer this question of labor force participation by women while remaining consistent to our norms and values, or morphing them a little bit, finding ways to adjust both things, finding compatibility there. Thank you very much, Hadia, for taking part in this.
Thank you, Ali. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Appreciate it.